Flutterbury. Flutterby is probably what it's called. Okay, the toys. Let's go to the toys. Power Up. It's called the Power Up 3. I don't know if I have the energy to do this. Because this is an engaging conversation. You're an interesting human being. And you do a wonderful job with all this apparatus. It's called the Power Up 3.0. Okay, so you're catching that sound. I want to see if you're catching that sound so that I can see if I need to turn it off. It's a whir in the background.
We're living with it anyway.
I can turn it off.
How difficult would that be?
Not difficult at all.
Okay.
Because it's not really turning it off. It just goes to sleep.
Yeah, maybe put it to sleep.
This is sticky. Okay. Do I want to get these sticky fingers on here? But I use this stuff so infrequently that the apparatus with which I make it has been lost.
Make what?
This concoction, the choline cocktail stuff.
What is this concoction?
It's called choline cocktail.
Mm-hmm.
It's this natural energizer.
What's it made out of?
Well, choline is stuff, you know, the brain operates, one of the major neurotransmitter systems is acetylcholine.
Mm-hmm.
So a couple of the things that are essential to the brain's system of neurotransmitters are choline, which is in eggs and a bunch of other stuff like that. It's more protein-oriented than sugar-oriented. And the sugar, I've only tried this twice. This is the second time I've tried this. We normally have orange juice to make this stuff, but since I eat it so infrequently, the orange juice just sits there in the refrigerator and goes bad. You know, if you do it twice a year and you can only keep orange juice for a week or two, that's a lot of orange juice you're going to have to buy and throw away. So I tried it, since we had no orange juice in the house, with this imitation maple syrup last week, because it was the only thing I had that would give the sugar that's in orange juice, even though it's, well, it's probably fructose because this is corn syrup. And it worked. It pepped me up. So, and I'm always on call to do radio or television. Coast to coast. Oh, I forgot to close the door. Coast to coast. Okay. Where am I?
You were saying coast to coast.
Coast to coast will call me as late as 11:30 at night and say, can you be on in an hour and a half? And they used to call Geo, and they used to say, do you know anything about the following subject? Well, that was for the first 40 shows, maybe, that I did. Maybe even 50. And then they realized that the answer had always been yes, no matter what the subject was. So they stopped asking that question, and these days they simply say, can you be on in an hour and a half?
Mm-hmm.
Well, the answer has to be yes. It always has to be yes. And I'm on call for Iranian and Saudi TV. I'll get up, you know, I get up at 3:00 in the afternoon. So when I wake up, sometimes there is a knock on my door from my assistant saying they want you at either Saudi or Iranian TV. And I have to be there as quickly as I can get dressed and get into town, period.
For Press TV?
Press TV, Al Alam TV, and for KSA2 TV, Kingdom of Saudi Arabia 2 TV. And they initially started me with a narrow range of subjects, and then they started to have fun by throwing me random subjects that I hadn't had any time to prepare for, because here we have two countries. Saudi Arabia and Iran are at war with each other in Syria. The Syrian war is not a civil war. It's a proxy war between Iran and Saudi Arabia. This is something Nancy Kissinger and I discussed at great length one day with Henry standing nearby. And yet, they share offices in Manhattan. So if you go in to do Iranian television, and your friends from Saudi TV see that you're there, they come to you as you come through the door, and they say, can you please do an interview with us too? Okay, so that means you're doing two interviews, right? Instead of just the one you had planned for. Not that you had time to plan. You have almost no time to do any research. And then there's a guy in the field who really loves doing you, but he's always out in the field someplace. Wait, we have to turn this on. That's what this little device is telling me. I have 2 8-hour recording clips that record everything. But there's nobody with any time to ever listen, so.
So you're recording?
Everything. Everything. They go on the minute I put my clothes on.
But you never listen to it, do you?
Nobody has time to listen to these. They get uploaded to the computer. And this tells me it's time to switch from one to the other.
Uh-huh.
So, because the other one might be running out. Okay, so they get you in there. You're seated in front of the camera like this. And all of a sudden, the cameraman, who should be paying attention to nothing but the interview, because he's also the guy often interviewing you, the cameraman gets a phone call, and he takes it. Why does he take it? It's because his reporter in the field is calling in. His reporter in the field, who you only met once, wears a suit, looks much more sophisticated than you do, doesn't speak English, or it doesn't feel he speaks English. When he gives you questions, he gives them to Muhammad, the cameraman, who in turn translates them into English for you. And apparently, this reporter in the field loves interviewing you. So whenever he hears that you're in the studio, he gets all excited, and he formulates a bunch of questions, and he phones them in to Muhammad, who's busy shooting you. So you came in to do an interview with Iranian television. You did your interview with Iranian television. Then your Iranian or your Saudi friends came up to you and said, could you please do an interview for us too? Okay, so you did an interview for them. Then the guy in the field wants to interview you too, and he phones in his questions, and you set up in a different location somewhere in the little office complex, and so that it doesn't look like exactly the same interview. And you do an interview on subject number 3, of course, which you've had no time to prepare for either. But since you marinate yourself in information, since you have news flowing through you constantly, not to mention stuff from science and philosophy and all kinds of strange areas of thought, you're prepped. You know, you somehow manage to pull off all of these things. So it's an amazing experience, and they're so wonderful to me. And the most wonderful thing that happens when I go up to do Saudi and Iranian television is that I follow the Islamic world like a hawk. That's why I've been picketed for 4 days by the American Arab Anti-Discrimination Committee saying that I'm a racist. That's why the Council for Arab-Islamic Relations has tried to make sure I never get another word in print again. Doesn't matter. In the Islamic world, they love me. They know I know what I'm talking about. They know I have read all the basic sources. They know I have read the Quran, that I have read the Hadith, and that I've read Ibn Ishaq and Al-Tabari, the two very first two biographers of Muhammad who were able to do his biography at a time when the memories were 5 generations old. It's like the Gospels. The Gospels were written 80 years, roughly, after Jesus died, but at least it was relatively close. These were the closest you could get to Muhammad's life. So they have a tremendous respect. It started with my role as a Zionist atheist Jew, so they could use me as the enemy and a foil. And ended up with them regarding me as a major figure, a major analyst of international affairs who can talk to them about any subject that they choose. So the last time the Iranians called, which was only 2 weeks ago, they called Lachette, my assistant, during the day when I'm asleep, and they said, look, we have a subject we know Howard doesn't know anything about. And this time they gave me a whole day's notice, 24 hours. But if we have him in the, we're going to rent a location for him. If we rent the location, we set up a 3-camera shoot for him. Can he be in at 4 o'clock tomorrow or 5 o'clock tomorrow? And can he talk about the subject? And the subject was minimum wage. Well, I do geopolitical affairs. I do international affairs. I don't do domestic affairs. That's not really that interesting to me. It's too close to home. It's not exotic enough. And yeah, I came in and did it. When I walked in, they had this incredible, they had rented this astonishing location. It was an ophthalmologist's shop, a glasses maker's shop, owned by a guy from Azerbaijan on 6th Avenue between Houston Street and Bleecker. And it was absolutely gorgeous. And they had one of the most gorgeous motorcycles. I used to ride a motorcycle. I used to commute to work on one. One of the most gorgeous motorcycles you've ever seen in your life in there, just as decor, and it must be a $37,000 motorcycle.
What is it?
I don't know. I didn't get to take a close look because I'm there for a performance. And it was astonishing, and they usually do a one-camera shoot. That's it. And there's usually a staff of an interviewer, at most an interviewer and the camera person. That's it. No. This was a full three-camera plus stills shoot. With a team of four people.
All about?
All for me. This is all just for me.
And the subject?
The subject was minimum wage. Now, they had told me minimum wage in New York City, so that's what I studied for 24 hours, crash program of study. And
do they pay you for this, by the way?
No, I just do it because I enjoy it. They paid me the first time I was on years ago, 5 or 6 years ago, and then it never occurred to me to ask them for payment since then. So I guess I'm cheap for them. But I don't want to be paid for this, Gio. I want to be able to say what I think is true, period. I don't want to feel like a paid shill for anything, not for a damn thing. Yes, if my audience decides to buy my books, that I'm pleased by, because those are the people that I owe my greatest obligation to. But no, I don't want to be bought by the Iranians. I don't want to be bought by the Saudis. But the privilege of being able to discuss the things going on in the world, like the proxy war, in Syria, between Saudi Arabia and Iran, like the global balance of forces in the Islamic world that this indicates, the past of it and the future of it. I can discuss that with these people. Two of them are from Iraq. One of them is from Egypt. One of them is Indian and is not even Islamic. And the other one is Iranian-American, but she grew up in America. So none of these people are actually gung-ho Iranian.
Who's the Iranian-American?
Suzanne Motoresi. You can find her on YouTube. She's wonderful to me, and she's just wonderful. It's terrific to deal with her. It's, I'm so pleased when I get a call. And you can discuss these affairs. You can discuss what's going on behind the scenes. You can discuss analyses that never appear in the American newspapers. And you can feel out which of your hypotheses are valid and which ones aren't, because they give you feedback. You can just read the feedback in their faces. Except this is the remarkable thing. Remember the six monkeys at six typewriters? You would think that some of your hypotheses would be wrong, but my hypotheses on what's going on in global affairs are based on reading Saudi Arabian sources, Egyptian sources, Southeast Asian sources, even Russian sources. Sources from all over the world, not American sources. Those are a dime a dozen. And so every hypothesis I've ever run across these people, they have beamed. It's like the experience with the theoretical physicists in Moscow. They have beamed. This hasn't been a hit and miss random matter, not at all. You know, in the same way that this hypothesis about the Big Bagel has been proven out over the course of 50 years of physics, these things prove out. They turn out to be true. Now, where the fuck you get the ability to infer that kind of thing, I do have an idea.
Tell me about it, because I'm interested to know where the fuck you get these things.
Because you saturate yourself with information. You follow the flow of information. You're in the flow of information every day. You breathe it. I have a friend named I'm forgetting his name right now, Dr. Alexander Elder. And Alex wrote what PBS called the Bible of Day Trading. Trading for a Living is the book. And Alex has to be in the flow of the market if he's going to trade. So if he spends a day away from the market, let's say a weekend, just one day of a weekend, He won't let himself trade until he's marinated himself in the market and feels its breath. He calls it its breath, again. I'm in the breath of global affairs all of the time. And what am I looking for? Exactly what you were talking about. We humans are pattern junkies, right? So I'm taking in patterns from genetics, genomics, cell biology, from philosophy, from all kinds of, but not strange places. The places of science are not strange, but all kinds of nooks and crannies of science, some of which the public never hears about, and many of which the public does. I was a major figure in evolutionary biology. There was a concept called individual selection. And when I walked into evolutionary biology and was basically recruited into the field in something like 1990 by the ethnographer of the Yanomamo, the fierce people. The Yanomami, yeah. The so-called fierce people.
Who's that?
Napoleon Chagnon.
Claudia Angular.
I don't know her.
Yeah, she's been with them maybe 30 years now as their translator.
Well, I first
I know the Yanomami fairly well.
Once upon a time, Michael Lang, who was one of the creators of Woodstock, called me while I was in the music industry. And some people in the music industry knew that I was really a scientist undercover or a scientific thinker undercover. And Michael said, there's this guy I just met that you need to talk to. His name is Jean-Claude Louillat, and he's an anthropological filmmaker. And he's showing a film at the United Nations. I'm going to arrange for you to go over and meet him. So I went over to the United Nations to this auditorium, and it was just the two of us. And Jean-Claude Louillat showed me this film of the Maasai making war in Africa. And he said something astonishing. There were two groups of men about 150 feet apart on a field, on a dusty field. And every once in a while, one would go way back and make a running start and throw a spear. And the other side would see it coming, and they'd part, and nothing would happen. And, you know, one out of 100 throws, this is where the six monkeys at six typewriters does work, one out of every 100 throws would hit somebody who didn't get out of the way in time. And if they were lucky, it would kill them. But that's one out of 1,000 times. And basically, nothing's happening. And Jean-Claude said, see that? That's what it looked like outside the walls of Troy. All of a sudden, that made sense. A big dusty field with seemingly almost nothing happening, but only in the mind of the narrator, the Homer, does it all come together and get condensed so you don't see the emptiness of the big fields and the big spaces of time in which nothing is happening. You only see the moments of action, and they all look condensed. So, and then he said, look, there's this book you've got to read. I'm going to lend you my copy. And he lends me a copy in French. In those days, I could read French. And when I first learned French, I wrote all my fiction in French without any mistakes. But that took years of discipline to accomplish. And now I don't know any French. But at any rate, so he lent me his copy in French. And it was a book called Yanomama. And it's Yanomamo in this case, rather than Yanomami. And it was by a woman whose parents had been, they had been missionaries on the Orinoco River. And one day they'd gone out on their canoe and a war canoe had attacked them. And her parents had been riddled with arrows. She was 11 years old and she had been taken. And she was immediately turned into a child bride, into a sexual prize by the Yanomama. And she lived with the Yanomama for the next 20 years. And everything Napoleon Chagnon would later say that he would be accused of making up is in this book, which was written before Napoleon Chagnon ever went to the Orinoco to see the Yanomamo. The people who said that Napoleon Chagnon was making up the fierceness and the warlikeness of the Yanomamo were full of shit. And they deliberately worked like mad to destroy Napoleon Chagnon's career in the name of a lie. That in reality, hey, you know, the only people who are violent are us Westerners, and indigenous people are all peaceful. That's totally horsepucky. And the people who promoted that idea were willing to kill the career of a very important anthropologist in order to promote this falsehood that indigenous people all live peacefully and all live in harmony with nature. It's horsepucky. If indigenous people all lived in harmony with nature, why were all of the oversized species in North and South America eradicated within a few hundred years of the time that Native Americans first got here as immigrants? Either 11,500 years ago, if you believe the standard interpretation, or if you read some of the newer research, possibly 18,000 years ago. Why? Because they're human too. And they have just as much violence as you and I do. And they use the technologies of their time to wipe out entire species. So a bunch of people were promoting a lie. But at any rate, Jean-Claude Liotte turned me on to this stuff. And by the time I started corresponding with Napoleon Chagnon, when I was extremely ill, around 1990, Chagnon said, look, I can't read a book called The Lucifer Principle, which was the book that I wanted him to read, because my career is under attack and people are trying to make sure I never go back to Brazil again. And I'm totally separated from the people I've dedicated my entire life to chronicling. But I want you to join a group called the Human Behavior and Evolutionary Society. So I did. And it turned out that they had a listserv. Remember listservs? Antique fossil left over from the early cyber times.
What year was that?
About 1989, 1990. And I joined the listserv and suddenly discovered I can't get out of bed and I can't talk, but I can communicate with these people by typing. And so I joined the group and discovered that evolutionary biology, one of the fields I had left behind when I left, when I didn't go to grad school, was predicated on this concept called individual selection. And individual selection didn't make any sense to me. I knew that if individual selection continued to reign, my ideas would never be taken seriously. So I put together something called the Group Selection Squad. And you know, I've spent my life finding subcultures and helping them find their voice. Well, in this case, I thought I would be out on a limb by myself. And all of a sudden, 40 other scientists came out of the woodwork from all over the world, Australia, Europe, all over the place, and said, thank God you're here. Thank God you're saying what you're saying. Up until now, if we uttered the term group selection, we were laughed out of the academy, we were forbidden to have publications any longer in the major journals, and we were knocked off of our tenure track. It was the end of our career. And we haven't been able to talk about it. Now you're talking about it for us. And they all backed me. And the one guy who had made a career out of championing group selection, who was very clever, started sending me these stentorian letters, saying, you must stop. What you're doing is going to end my career. I wouldn't listen to him. If you're pursuing a truth, you're pursuing a truth. And I told him, once we finally opened the line of communication, instead of him just shouting at me, that I would turn this situation around in a year. He said, no, you can't. This is science. It takes the die off of an entire generation to promote a new idea. It'll take 20 years. I said, no, I'll do it in a year. And a year later, I had him on the cover of the New York Times Tuesday Science section in a six-column piece, and that turned the tide on group selection. So I've been an activist in the scientific community when I... But I need to do a Howard the Humongous.
Well, on that note,
yeah.
I had a conversation, another conversation, with Benoit Malebrat.
Yeah.
And... he was telling me something about how science is influenced by government and by propaganda and people who have self-interest.
Right.
And so I asked him, would you say that on camera? He said, no.
Well, look at his career, okay? He rejected Sorbonne-style positions, but he accepted a position from a business machine company.
Well, he also told me about being, you had to graduate from Yale to be a tenured Yale.
And
so he was the oldest tenured Yale because they kind of pumped him in there to be a graduate of Yale before he gave him a...
Amazing. And he didn't need that at all.
No, but he took it because, who knows why he took it.
Yeah. And I was not willing to waste that kind of time. It's so hard to get into mass human emotions. It's very hard. You have to get into government. For a science nerd, how do you penetrate government? A science nerd without any credentials, without any graduate degrees. By the time it was ready for me to go to grad school, I had spent something like 60% to 70% of my life in science. At the age of 12, I had my meeting with the head of the Graduate School of Physics at the University of Buffalo. I was accepted as somebody who would automatically get into any grad school in theoretical physics in the country you wanted at the age of 12. At the age of 12, I was being tutored privately by the head of research and development for the Moog Valve Corporation, who was making the very advanced valves it took to get an X-1 and X-2 to be the very first space planes. By the time I had my grad school fellowships, at the age of 24, I guess it was, in 1967 or 1968, 25, I'd been in science so long I needed to get out of science to find the material that a scientific mind can cope with, can understand. I needed to do a voyage of the Beagle by then to get out into the empirical world. And of course, my empirical world was not the world of butterflies and the things that Darwin collected and birds. It was the world of real human beings doing real things that counted in the real world. Superstars like Michael Jackson and Bob Marley and Bette Midler. I helped establish Amnesty International's first base in the United States, in North America. I helped put FarmAid on the map. I did the first public service radio spots for solar power. I worked with the NAACP and the Black United Fund. I risked my whole career over and over again, but I risked my entire career to get Michael Jackson to accept having NAACP voter registration booths at all of the stadiums where the Jacksons were going to be appearing on their victory tour. Why was that risking my career? Because Michael was a religious person, and Michael was a Seventh-day Adventist or something like that. And it was against his religion to be involved with any sort of voting or political process. It was against his religion. And people said, you can't go to Michael with that. Fuck, I can't go to Michael with that. If he doesn't do this, he's going to alienate his black base. And his black base matters. If those people don't know that he cares about them, they will abandon him. And that will undermine his career. Nor does he ever want to alienate them. He wants his people to be with him in everything that he does. And if it violates his religion, so be it. It's a necessary synapse between him and his people to do this on behalf of his own people, who haven't had rights, voting rights, until now. And he can help attract people to sign up for those voting rights. So it doesn't matter if I'm threatening my fucking career. If I'm talking to you on behalf of a vital truth, I don't care. I really don't care. And that's why people said that Howard's the only one who can influence Michael, who can talk to Michael. So, you know, the truth at any price, including the price of your life, is a scientific principle.
So what was that like, talking to Michael?
Well, that's a long story, which I'll tell you tomorrow, because it's a long story, and I have to stand up to show you how it works. So we'll have to set the camera up differently, or you won't understand the body language that's involved, and that's crucial. That's absolutely crucial. Okay, let's see if we can do a Howard the Humongous, because my energy's running down again. Let me drink some more of this goop, this sugar stuff.
Now, while we're doing that, let me... static electricity.
I know. So there you have it. An example of what Benjamin Franklin was trying so hard to figure out when he did something that every scientist you've ever seen denies is done in science, used a metaphor of a stream powering a water wheel, and came up with the idea that either your finger or that piece of plastic is the equivalent of something up here, and the other is the equivalent of something down here, and there is a transfer of some sort between the two. One of the basic ideas of, well, behind a current and behind electromagnetism, which would later be identified as one of the four forces holding things together in this entire cosmos by the sophisticated modern theoretical physics of the 21st century. So, and you just demonstrated it all by yourself.
Right, static electricity.
Yeah, should we start a new
okay
file?
So now, yeah. Before we start that,
right,
explain to me So, since
but remember, I have to put a Howard the Humongous episode up tonight to catch people on Sunday while they still have a day off.
Oh, is that how that works?
Yes, and it's very much like the stream going over, because once it's past Sunday night, it's too late.
But Sunday, so you have a couple of days in order to...
No, tomorrow's Sunday.
Oh, that's right.
It's Sunday in 6 minutes.
In 6 minutes?
Yeah.
And we've been talking now for 4 hours?
Well, let's see. We started at what time? We started
8 o'clock,
at 8 o'clock.
A little bit after 8.
No, it's only 3 hours. It's a little bit less than 3 hours, Gio. It may seem like 4 hours, but...
Well, I'm enjoying
it. Yeah, I'm enjoying it.
And so Howard the Humongous Show, while I'm explaining it to me, what it is.
Okay. I'm trying... Remember what Axel's Castle by Edmund Wilson did for me when I was totally confused about T.S. Eliot. It gave me a new perceptual lens with which to see something I hadn't understood until then. I'm trying to give people perceptual lenses in 8 to 18 minutes, sometimes an hour and a half, with which to see not just a little picture that you can see with a lens, but to give them the kind of lens that they can use to piece the whole damned thing together. From theoretical physics to the relationship between Iran, Saudi Arabia, the United States, China, and Russia. I want them to be able to see the news through the same kinds of lenses that they see the cosmos. Now, that's ridiculous. In science, that's not acceptable. Fuck science, because the obligation of science is an aspiration to omniscience. And if science can't knit all these things together, then science is failing to be science. So I'm trying to pull all those things together with what you identified, that obsession with pattern recognition that is what it is to be a human. But it's not just unique to us, this obsession with pattern recognition. A single cell, a bacterium, has to sense the patterns in its environment, has to make sense out of them, has to put them through a filter and see a common underlying pattern so that it can sense the chemotactic signal, that fading signal of chemicals that comes from food. And the chemotactic signal, another fading signal, chemical signal, that comes from things that could be poisonous. And even the signals that could indicate the onslaught of a predator. It has to be aware of these things. Periodically, it'll go straight up a chemotactic gradient toward what it seems to be food. Or it has to sometimes scoot across a landscape on which there are no signals whatsoever, taking a chance that there will be food after a voyage. It takes that voyage with 10,000 other bacteria. But if it makes the wrong decision, periodically it stops. It attaches a tail, in many cases, to something that's stable in the landscape, like anchoring itself, and it swivels around in a little circle to check. You do that. I do that. We're very certain of something. We proceed with it. We become uncertain, we swivel. And then we reorient and we go again. It's an old pattern left over from bacteria. And if the bacteria doesn't get the right underlying pattern, it doesn't survive. And if the entire colony, which acts as a collective brain, which pools the information from 7 trillion inhabitants, more inhabitants in one little bacterial city, than all the humans who have ever existed on the face of the earth. So if that 7 trillion getting its collective brain together doesn't find the underlying patterns in its environment and make correct decisions, it's gone. It's gone. The whole thing, like Mexico disappearing from the face, like Mexico City disappearing from the face of the earth. It's not unique to us humans to be pattern addicts. It's unique to life to be pattern addicts. Even DNA reflects the patterns in its environment. The historical patterns, the patterns that underlie the history. Is something going wrong on the... Okay. So, pattern recognition is essential to life from the very beginning of life, from the existence of the first cell onward. The first cell has to know how the patterns of oxygen and phosphorus and sulfur work, to put them together, how the patterns of DNA, when it encounters the natural stuff of an environment, works. It has to be able to find the environment which its mechanism, its internal mechanism, its whole DNA system, its whole library of information, develops a how-to library. Well, what's a how-to library? I have two libraries, a library of techniques that'll work over and over and over again within a certain amount of circumstances.
I have to ask you this question.
Yeah.
So, bear with me.
Yeah.
I was thinking about where the mind comes from.
Yeah.
You know, because we have minds that we worship, and we build warships to our minds.
Right,
we build
right.
religions. We build.
Right.
We worship. We build. We have all this conceptualization that we
right.
worship. You know, knowledge.
Right.
So I was trying to decipher, and I was saying, well, what is the mind? Where does that come from? What is, you know, it's like your question about life.
Right.
And I said to him, okay, so let me think. If I'm a single cell animal.
Right.
What are my concerns? My concern is survival,
mm-hmm.
food.
Right.
Reproduction.
Right.
And more survival.
Right. Well, you have some other concerns.
Yeah,
the survival of your social unit.
Well, that's
sustains
also,
you,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, that's also all part of the two survivals.
And the survival beyond the time of your own individual existence.
Well, that's reproduction.
Yeah. Okay.
So it's really, so a single cell animal meets a brick wall. They can't get around. They can't get through it. It can't fuck it, and it can't eat it.
Right. But it might be able to use it as housing.
Right. So, you have your mind and my mind, we've kind of looked at these things. Are we much different than the single cell animal?
We have more in common with the single cell animal than we can possibly imagine. And my second book, Global Brain, The Evolution of Mass Mind from the Big Bang to the 21st Century, starts with the evolution of a collective brain in a bacterial colony. Because those bacteria, Eshelman Jacob, there are two guys who've developed this concept, and it's James Shapiro at the University of Chicago and Eshelman Jacob at the University of Tel Aviv. But Eshel comes at this from a very strange point of view. He's a condensed matter physicist. He's not a biologist. And yet he's made his mark in microbiology. Why? Because Eshel looked at the patterns of bacterial colonies establishing themselves in a petri dish. And he discovered that they have, back to Benoit Mandelbrot, fractal patterns. And he thought, now, you know, we can account for fractal patterns with the mathematics underlying mineralogy. Because we see fractal patterns in rocks, cut them in half, polish them up, and what do you see? The most amazing patterns. It's
marble.
Astonishing. Right. And so if we apply the mathematics of condensed matter physics to a bacterial colony, we can probably predict using fractals how the colony will unfold, even if the colony is not made of anything living. And he tried that. And that wasn't what satisfied him, not at all. He discovered that the colony has a kind of collective intelligence, because there are 7 trillion members. It's Eshel who told me that if you have a bacterial colony the size of your palm, it'll be so thin that you can't even see it. And yet it will contain 7 trillion members. And it's me who figured out that that's more than all the humans who've ever existed. But Eshel's work was on the cover of the Scientific American in 1998.
It's not Escher, Eshel.
Eshel, E-S-E.
Not the painter, not the
No,
artist.
Like a bushel.
Right, okay.
And Eshel, in 1998, I had been in bed for 10 years. I was at least out of the woods in terms of being able to talk and have another person in the room. So Eshel and his wife were coming through New York. And they came out to Park Slope.
Where we are now.
Yeah, to
and
see
this,
me.
This...
To this bed. They came out to this bed. And at that point, I had magazines lying all over the bed. Because I used to mark up the table of contents to magazines and then send them to a reader, a woman who was about 3'5" and was suffering from dwarfism. She couldn't walk. But her disability and my disability fit each other. She at least was able to speak. So she read these things with a voice that sounded like she had just inhaled an incredible amount of helium. Squeaking! So she squeaked these things onto cassettes for me, and I would be able to listen to them while I was going to the bathroom and laying in the bed, God knows what I was doing, eating meals, stuff like that. And so Eshel's wife asked if I had the latest copy of the Scientific American. Well, of course, I have the latest copy of everything. It was under my left leg. I knew exactly where it was, my left thigh. And she said, have you seen what's on the cover? Well, no, the answer is no. I never see what's on the cover. I simply open it to the table of contents and mark out the articles that I want Polly Hurd to read. So I got the Scientific American, which was turned to the table of contents, and she says, now look at the cover. Okay, so I looked at the cover. Guess what was on the cover? The cover was Eschel's photographs of bacterial colonies making these fractal patterns. It was amazing. So Eschel and I work together, dialogue together, still do for a long, long time. But the point is, the bacterial colony has an intelligence. Each member of the colony is picking up a certain amount of information and in various chemical ways sending it back to the center. But you have to realize, we think we are a big deal because we have brains, you know, 100 trillion cells that'll do things that a chimpanzee's brain won't. But this is not unique in the cosmos, because DNA is just as sophisticated as a brain, and like a brain, it is a storage mechanism and a storage retrieval mechanism. It carries the lessons of, at this point, billions of years of experience dealing with the empirical world. And it's those things that spot patterns and manage to fit the patterns of that external world survive. And those elements that don't fit the patterns of the external world, the real empirical world, what my dad used to call the real world, they don't survive. And the library of these lessons is in DNA, and there may be 3 billion atoms working as a team in one molecule of DNA. So the bacterial colony has its own kind of brain, its own kind of information storage, sorting, pattern spotting, and retrieval mechanism. It's DNA. Plus, it has all kinds of experience stored in cells, in cell walls, cytoplasm, and organelles like mitochondria. So this brain work goes on without mind as we know it. Mind is a very, we don't even know what mind is, but mind is conscious of itself.
Do you have any theories on that?
No, because two of the great mysteries right now are life and mind, and at least science is coping with mind. Consciousness has been a popular field in science for 30 years.
So let me run something by you, going back to our single cell animal.
Will we ever get to the Howard the Humongous episode? I'll run out of energy.
So you're a single cell animal, and you bump into something.
Yeah.
And you keep on bumping into that something.
Right.
And all of a sudden, you get this kind of callus.
Yeah.
Because you're bumping into it.
Right, but callus is an active response to your environment.
Right, because you've got to have...
That's experience already.
Right. So there's,
that's
learned. That's what I'm saying. It keeps on going...
If you have the capability of developing a callus.
Well, we're going back to primordial...
But remember, some of these bacteria are inventive. Not inventive necessarily as individuals, but inventive as a group. And they develop an adhesion device that allows them to stick to that surface, because that surface is going to be stable.
Right.
If they think it's going to be in the line of a food supply.
Right. So we're back to food, reproduction and survival. But here, listen, follow my thought on
this.
Because I've thought about this, and I wonder what your thoughts on this. So we keep on, as we bump our, as a single cell, primordial, early first cell.
Right.
You know, no history, no memory, no nothing. It's just who knows what's in it. But it keeps on bumping. And in that bumping, it develops basically a callus, and which then becomes the front end of you know, because it doesn't know where a front end is.
Right.
But it figures out, well, if I'm going to keep on bumping into these things. So that becomes a kind of a very primitive putting together pattern, nuance, and it becomes a skull, let's say, because our heads are harder than any part of our body, because maybe that's an evolutionary development, as some would think. But my thought is that in that kind of callus development is how, so then the brain starts shortcutting.
Right.
Certain actions.
Right.
But here's the real question that goes back to your politics.
Right.
Is that here we are, these cells of our body, We have billions of cells in our body.
Right.
And they all, for the most part, trust each other.
Right.
They collaborate, you know, just to have this conversation.
You have to read the first book, The Lucifer Principle. You must read it.
So, but the point is, so we have this whole human trust.
Right.
In our DNA and in our ecology as a body.
Right, but it's a complex thing, that
it's
trust.
A complex thing. But yet, as a collective organization of human beings, there's very little trust between us.
There's more trust than you think.
Maybe because, so, but I'm no, just saying, look at all the wars, the violence, the fear,
but
the propaganda.
The fact is that wars come out of trust. Do you know why? Because a social group comes together and manages to increase its level of trust and its level of cohesion by demonizing another group. Groups come together around the demonization of rival groups. They define themselves by their demonization of rival groups. Demonization of a rival group, what you've referred to as distrust, is a mechanism for establishing trust between the members of the group that's demonizing the outgroup.
So I've been studying fear.
Right.
And the power of fear.
Right.
And I've come to recognize in that the fear, our greatest fear, is the fear of loneliness.
Right.
And of not belonging.
Right.
So people will kill themselves, like in suicide
in
bombers.
In order to belong,
In order to belong. But then again, we have all these, what I call, you know, we have nationalism, tribalism, all these culturalisms, all these isms. I call them the ism of schism.
Right.
Because in one way, we think they're bringing us together, like you talk about, because it's, but yet they tear us apart from our humanity. So who are we? Are we nations, tribes, or human beings
first?
Well,
we're constantly redefining that. I mean, once upon a time, only 150 years ago, or possibly 200 years ago, because I've had trouble finding a history that will tell you the story, no such concept as a nation existed. It didn't exist. We've evolved it multi-generationally over the course of the last 200 years. And because we're not conscious of the history of how it came to be, we think it's been forever. But it hasn't been forever. When the Bible says, without a vision, a people shall perish, it's not thinking of a modern state. It's not thinking of a modern nation. It's thinking of a tribal group that manages to trace its cohesion according to its genetic lineage. You know, and from Abraham there came Saul, and from Saul there came Lot. I have got it all wrong. But the begats in the Bible are a way of saying who our tribe came from. It's like a bacterial colony 5 years after its founding, keeping track of the names of its ancestors. And tracing itself back to one ancestor. Well, we traced ourselves back to Abraham. So we invent new forms of social organization. We invent things like the corporation. We invent things like the nation state. Once upon a time, about 2,600 years ago, we invented the empire for the very first time, for the very, very, very first time upon planet Earth, a human empire. But bacteria, which get together in groups of 7 trillion, what would you call a group of 7 trillion human beings that all work together? 7 trillion. Remember, we're only 7 billion today. 7 trillion's 1,000 times as much. And we think that 7 trillion humans, I'm sorry, the world has no room for them. There are not enough resources for them. Well, look, we have a big universe here. There are resources just above our heads. It took 30 minutes for SpaceX's rocket to get into outer space with its 7-ton satellite last week. It took 30 minutes for the Indians to put their Mars probe into Earth orbit, from which they were able to loop it toward Mars. 30 minutes above our head, and in some cases 8 minutes above our head, are all the resources of the universe, and they make the resources of the Earth look like a speck of dust in a football stadium, but something even bigger than a football stadium. And here we are thinking we're using the resources of this Earth. Well, what are the resources that we've been using? What has life been using? Poisons and inanimate things, the very things we don't think are resources. So for every million, or for every single ounce of life stuff on this planet today, there are 220 million ounces of inanimate material waiting to be animated, waiting to be turned into life stuff. And we think we've run out of resources because of some crazy, nutty picture of the invisible world with which we are confining and strangling ourselves. We're cutting off our own oxygen supply because imagination is the oxygen of the human soul, and we're killing off our souls. But what we don't realize, because we are so incredibly ethnocentric, is that while we are killing off our souls, the Chinese, the Malaysians, are not. The people of Asia are seeing themselves at the very beginning of their life course, and we are seeing ourselves at the end. And that picture of the invisible world, the picture that we are a dying civilization choking on a planet whose resources we have consumed, that's killing us. We are killing ourselves with a picture of the invisible world. There are very valid things in the ecological worldview. In the 1960s, we learned not to poison ourselves with our air supply, something China has not yet learned, although it knows it has to learn it. And in New York City, if you remember in 1964, if you make the mistake of walking out of your apartment in 1964 with a clean white shirt and a clean white pair of pants, thinking that you'll look wonderfully, dazzlingly refreshing, by noon, your pants and your shirt are no longer white. They're gray. And in every horizontal crease by 3 o'clock in the afternoon, every horizontal crease is black. Why? Because you're at NYU and you're only a few blocks away from the Con Ed smokestacks at 14th Street and the East River, and they're pouring out pollutants. They're pouring out smoke. And smoke is not only settling on every horizontal crease in your white shirt and pants, meaning you should stop wearing white shirts and pants, but it's settling in your lungs. It's killing you. These are called particulates. They kill. And by roughly 1975, thanks in part to a guy named, of all people, Richard Nixon, who you hate, loathe, and despise, but who started the first EPA, Environmental Protection Agency. Thanks to the works of those damned eco-thinkers, your air is clean. You can go out in white shirt and pants, and you can live 10 years longer because you're not going to die of lung cancer because of breathing particulates from Con Ed smokestacks. Well, this has happened all over the Western world by 1975 or so. London, which 114 people would die at a time when there was a serious smog attack in England. Los Angeles was known for its smog above anything else.
I remember.
Yeah.
I was there.
And it's not that...
You could see down the block.
Right. And it's not that way anymore. And it's not that way anymore thanks to ecological thinking. But any good thing in overdose is a poison. We have come nowhere near consuming the supplies, the resources of this planet, because resources are not given to us by God. They are made by human cleverness. Last year's wilderness is tomorrow's resource. Last year's pollutant is tomorrow's fuel supply. Once upon a time, that stuff leaking from rocks, rock oil, petro means rock, rock chemicals, were regarded as a pollutant. Then people began to see their use for things like the kind of fiery bundles that ships, warships, would toss at each other in the days of the Byzantine Empire. Then they were seen as possible medicines that you could apply to wounds and things like that. That was the middle of the 19th century. And then a grocer. Well, first of all, two guys, one in Poland, one in Canada, three of them, one in the United States, were trying to figure out how to replace, were trying to figure out how to give the poor of the earth something only the rich have been able to afford. Dostoevsky in his novels puts you outside as a poor person at 2 o'clock in the morning outside of a mansion. And the mansion shows that it is the home of the rich by blazing with light. And people drive up in carriages and go up the stairs and into the light. And they dance until 3 or 4 in the morning because that's a privilege only the rich have. You have darkness if you go back home, the way that Abraham Lincoln had nothing but darkness after the sun went down and had to do his reading by the light of the fire that was keeping the place warm and wasn't designed to allow him to read books. Somebody had invented, first of all, they'd invented a pure white light source that made it possible for the rich to dance until 3 a.m. It was sperm oil. And it cost the equivalent of $200 a gallon. Now, how much sperm oil would you buy at $200 a gallon? Not very much. You would be poor. You would live in darkness. Then came somebody who invented an inexpensive candle for the first time. Paraffin. That wasn't good enough. Somebody wanted to invent an artificial substitute that would be cheaper than whale oil. And three guys did. One in America, one in Canada, one in Poland. And it was called, they made it from this damned goop that was a poison called rock oil. Petrochemicals. It was called kerosene. And a grocer in Ohio who had grown up so poor it was ridiculous with an absentee father who was a con man, grew up under the worst of all circumstances, learned how to maximize the grocery business, and then became interested in this kerosene stuff and developed ways to refine it. And then it was becoming a big thing. There were 180, at least 180 different wildcat refiners. There's another guy who drilled the ground for water, to make water wells. Thought, what would happen if instead of waiting for the rock to leak out of the oil, or the oil to leak out of the rock, I took one of my pieces of well equipment and drilled, but instead of drilling for water, I drilled for this oil that oozes out of the rocks. Would I find oil down there? Well, he tried it. His name was Drake. In Pennsylvania. And sure enough, guess what he found? Oil. So by the time the grocer in Cleveland came along, there were 180 of these wildcat drillers. And they were all trying to sell you the kerosene made from their oil. So you'd, and every 5-gallon thing of kerosene came with a lamp, so it could get you hooked on using it for lighting. So you would take the kerosene, pour it into the lamp, set, everything was set exactly right, you'd light the lamp, and whammo, you'd have light for a fraction of the cost that the rich were paying for sperm oil. But when you ran out of your 5-gallon thing of kerosene, you'd go down to the store to buy another one. But the other one would come from another wildcatter and refiner, and it wouldn't have the same chemical properties as what you'd just been using. And you'd pour it into your lamp, and whammo, the lamp would explode in your face. So what the guy from Ohio, from Cleveland, came up with was he offered to buy your business if you were a wildcatter, and if you wouldn't sell it to him, he'd drive you out of business. He was mean. He was vicious. He was determined, and he got hold of every single one of those 180 wildcatter establishments, bought them all up, and then standardized the oil so it would have the exact same chemical composition no matter what jug or can it came out of.
Standard oil.
That's right.
By Rockefellers.
That's right. And then he made a deal with the railroads. The railroads didn't like dealing with these wildcatters. They didn't like hauling the cargo of oil around, because sometimes there'd be incredible amounts of the oil to haul, and sometimes there'd be none. And you, if you're in the railroad business, you're not going to build a $200,000 tanker for a supply of business that's there for 3 months and gone for 9 months. It doesn't pay. So he went to the railroads, the grocer from Cleveland, and said, look, I'll make you a deal. I will guarantee you a steady supply of business every single month of the year if you give me a break on the cost of transporting this stuff. And by the time this guy, who was later portrayed as a villain, had finished getting all these companies together and working out the railroad deals that he was later accused of doing in an underhanded way, no, he wasn't doing them in an underhanded way. You know why? It had cost $200 a gallon for this fucking stuff that the rich could only afford, and that kept you in darkness. Now you could buy kerosene for 6 cents a gallon. thanks to this monster of a man named John David Rockefeller, who once he got his hands on the money, gave it away in all kinds of charities, charities that built black colleges, charities that built all kinds of amazing things, the same way Carnegie gave his libraries when he standardized steel.
Well, it's interesting, all these guys, how they made their money was through devious methods often.
They were called devious methods.
Well, but
when people wanted to demonize methods. Yeah, but we all do manipulative methods. When I try to convince you to come over to shoot an episode of Howard the Among Us, I'm trying to influence your behavior. When you want to come over and do me for a day and a dinner with Andre, you're trying to influence my behavior. But most of the things that we call, you have to differentiate. Again, any good thing in overdose is a poison. Which forms of whatever you want to call it, manipulation, which forms benefit the two of us? Which forms are synergistic and produce a whole that's bigger than the sum of its parts? And which things steal from the whole and diminish it in its size? And until you've analyzed that, it's not fair to call anything manipulative, because you don't know what the positive sum is. And the positive sum of what Rockefeller was doing benefited the general public and uplifted the poor so dramatically that it added the equivalent of 6 years to the life of an average poor person, because it added an extra 5 hours every single day of the week to his or her life. And John David Rockefeller did not get credit for that. Plus, in the 1920s, there were heating systems developed using oil. And once you had a heating system that worked on oil, you could have central heating for a building. And when you had central heating for a building, people lived longer, because those thermoregulatory systems that drain so much of your energy, and that during two seasons of the year, spring and fall, make you terribly vulnerable to illness, you had regular heating in your home at a standard temperature. And that kept you much healthier, because it didn't challenge your thermoregulatory system and make you spend life force, of which you have a limited amount, on simply coping with heat and cold. So it's important to look at the bigger synergistic effect and the extent to which the pie is being expanded before accusing anybody of being manipulative.
It's interesting, both Rockefeller and Carnegie Mellon.
Right.
So they found it easier to make money and harder to give it away.
I wonder why. I have no idea. I never studied their philanthropic things. But we should do a Howard the Among Us, because I've run out of energy. I don't even remember what my Howard the Among Us is about. And I only have one episode prepared for tonight. I wanted to do three or four. And if we wait until tomorrow to do Howard the Among Us's, I'll miss Sunday, but I'm out of energy.
And it already is Sunday.
Yeah, it already is Sunday. So I won't get it up until Monday night, so I'll miss the weekend, but I might have to do that, because we can try to do a Howard the Among Us. We should probably do that.
Well,
I love this roaming around. I mean, mm-hmm. You know, that's really what I enjoy. But
me
I
too.
Try to do it in a different format for the Howard the Among Us crowd.
Well, I don't usually find somebody who I can actually talk to about these things.
Really?
Yeah.
But you go out finding geniuses, so.
So now let me ask you a question.
You're a genius hunter.
What is a genius? And I have my own theory on that, but I want to hear yours.
Okay. A genius is not necessarily somebody who's any brighter than you are. Not any brighter at all. It's somebody who's willing to stand outside of the establishment and take in all of the bits and pieces of establishment way of doing things as if they were tiles, and use them as tiles in a mosaic that nobody's put together before. It's somebody who, either through the gift I was given, which is the gift of being a perpetual exile and not allowed into social groups initially, and then keeping myself out of social groups because that's all I knew, or somebody who, despite being inside of social groups, is able to develop a mental distance, a perceptual distance from what's going on around them, who can put together patterns in a way that they've never been put together before. What was Leonardo da Vinci's genius? It wasn't in painting. there's really nothing very special about the Mona Lisa. We've been conditioned to think there's something special about the Mona Lisa, but no, I'm sorry. I've seen a lot more exciting paintings in my time.
I've been to the Louvre.
Yeah.
And right alongside the Mona Lisa is a number of other paintings.
Right.
And I believe the challenge in the Mona Lisa, which I think, at least for me, was in how Leonardo was able to suck you in, because you can't figure out what is on her face.
Uh-huh.
You can't figure out what's in her mind.
Yeah.
You can't tell by whether she's smiling or not, or whether...
Right.
Or whether... So his brilliance there was in that one. Yeah, I mean,
right.
The other ones don't have it.
Right.
Was that he got it.
Right.
He got that image of, what is she doing?
Right.
And that's...
But even though he's remembered for the Mona Lisa, that's not
really...
He was
an amazing mind.
He was an omnologist. I mean, you know, I created this field called omnology, for sophomores in college who are interested in art history, biology, psychology, and film. And parents, adults, tell them, schmuck, wake up. You're nobody until you make up your mind. What do you want to be, a biologist, a psychologist, an art historian, or a filmmaker? Make up your mind. And omnology is designed to allow you to say to those people who tell you this, screw you. I have four different curiosities. I'm going to follow all of them. I'm going to use each of them as a guide to a jigsaw puzzle piece of a kind that nobody's ever found before, because they've never looked for this pattern of jigsaw puzzle pieces before. And by the time my classmates, who do everything that you tell them to do, pick a specialization, become orthodontists, are 40 years old, and when they are having a midlife crisis and can't figure out why the hell are on planet Earth and buy little red sports cars and pick up blondes and cheat on their wives, I'm going to be coming back from the vast wastelands and jungles of film, biology, psychology, and art history, and whatever other curiosity comes to me along the way. And I'm going to be coming back with this jumble of puzzle pieces, having put them together in a pattern no one has ever had before. And I will know why I'm of value to humanity. I will know that I'm presenting a point of view that is unique and is enlightening somebody in either some tiny and microscopic way that could be vitally important, or in some major way. So that's what omnology is defined for. And who, of course, created the pattern of omnology, at least in modern times? Leonardo da Vinci.
Well, Leonardo da Vinci was an octopus. He had what I call curiosity-itis.
Oh, yes. And that's a great value. If you have that, keep it alive.
But to me, what I've recognized, a genius is simply somebody who's interested in what they're doing. If you're interested in what you're doing, you're an octopus. You want to milk every nuance, every subtleness, every little...
But there's something else you discover, because you have to have discipline to be a genius.
You have to have
both discipline and wildness simultaneously. Look at the discipline of all of this.
but I believe you have to have that interest. You have to have that spark.
Oh, yeah, that's...
You have to have that...
That's your engine.
That's your engine. And it's not some
mythical...
And the
discipline is your chassis and your wheels.
It's not something about talent. You know,
right.
We keep on getting that mixed up. Because we say, oh, this person's talent. That's not talent.
No, there's no inherent thing. It's like saying that a river is always the river, when in fact the river is always changing.
Right.
And it's the flow of the river that makes the difference. And the flow comes from curiosity. And so there's another part of omnology. Mm-hmm. And the other part of omnology says... Don't forget what your curiosity is all about. When a new curiosity comes along, follow it. If an old curiosity dies, leave it if that's what you have to do. Follow the course of the river where it's flowing. Don't get stuck on the land, basically. And that means that there are some days when you wake up in the morning, you've lost your enthusiasm about life, you're radically insecure about everything. You get a work, you establish, you have to have an infrastructure of habit, that a daily routine, no matter how wild you are. You must have a daily routine that allows you to get things together and get yourself in motion. And once you get your first half hour or 45 minutes of work under your system, you achieve liftoff. It's like being a plane on a runway. And at a certain point, your wings begin to take hold. The aerodynamic effect begins to take hold. But be very conscious of the fact that during the day, some things are going to interest you and some things are not. And in the name of discipline, keep yourself going toward those things you need to have to achieve your goal. But at the same time, nourish enough of those little individual interests to keep you alive and fresh and going, to fuel you, to keep you excited about what you're doing. And it's an internal process, like the process of rafting on the Mississippi River in 1860, which Mark Twain talked about, and which one of the Lowells talked about when writing an essay on Abraham Lincoln and why he was what he was as a politician. And this was an essay that began while Abraham Lincoln was still alive, and then ended after Abraham Lincoln was dead, when everybody finally appreciated what Abraham Lincoln was. Remember, Abraham Lincoln had been considered as an ignorant guerrilla who was creating an ugly stain on the White House because he didn't have the dignity, and he didn't have the brains, and he didn't have the sophistication to be president. He was a big mistake as far as people were concerned in his time. It wasn't until he was killed that people realized what they had lost. And in this essay by one of the Lowells, it says that Lincoln had the skill of a Mississippi rafter. He was able to feel the currents. He was able to feel the currents that were going to continue flowing down the river. He was able to feel those currents that would carry him onto a sandbank or into the bank of an island that would have destroyed his entire voyage. He was able to feel the little vibrations in each of those logs of which a raft is composed. And that's your process in being an omnologist. That's your process in riding yourself every single day to feel out those currents that are the swiftest, those currents that are going to carry you in the direction you want to go, and to feel out those currents that will ditch you, that will destroy you. And it's a moment-by-moment thing, feeling out the course of your curiosities. And of course, one of the curious things here is that the metaphor is essential. It's very similar to the metaphor that Benjamin Franklin was using to describe electricity, except electricity provides a reliable current, and the Mississippi is one that can break you in a million different ways.
Interesting. You talked about discipline.
Right.
What is your relationship to discipline?
I absolutely have to have it. I've chosen a course that's so eccentric that there you normally don't realize it, but you have an infrastructure of habit. You are required to show up at a certain time every day at your job. You are required to work until they give you a lunch break. You're given a set of fellow humans with whom to interact. You're given a set of rituals that tell you who's on top and who's on bottom and how you can behave with each person around you. And you're given a time to leave. And then you're given certain rituals for staying online a certain amount when you're home at night with your cell phone, texting, and a bunch of things like that. If you choose to be utterly independent, you have no structure. You have no ritual, none whatsoever. So you have to invent your own ritual or you will be totally incapable of achieving the things that you want to achieve. And my ritual is extremely strict. I get up at 8 o'clock in the morning, precisely. I go to the bathroom, get out of the bathroom, wearing no clothes whatsoever, do my push-ups very first thing before I can run out of the energy for them or the discipline for them. Do roughly 350 push-ups all in a row. Go fuck you to age because I'm 70 years old and I'm not supposed to be capable of this. And it's a great thing to go fuck you to nature. It's wonderful to triumph over nature. Take my pills. Remember, I was sick in bed for 15 years, so I've got a lot of medications that I have to take and I have to give myself an injection every morning. So I go through that ritual, which takes half an hour, go into the bathroom. All this time, Gio, I am listening to stuff. All this time, I am listening to magazines on my Kindle. They're being read to me while I'm fumbling in the drawer to take out the various different pills and things go into the bathroom, I plug the Kindle, which is reading out loud to me, into an old boombox and use it as an amplifier. So the bathroom is filled with magazine articles and journal articles while I take a bath and shave and do a bunch of isometrics that I've worked out, an isometric routine, which I'll have to put on film or something at some time so other people can use it. It's very simple, and it does wonderful things for your body. Get out, sit down with my laptop in a bath, still in a bathrobe, no clothes on, basically, and on the laptop, work out what my assistant has to do for the day. I have a 15 minute to half an hour meeting with my assistant. I send her a copy of the file that I've worked out with the stuff she has to do. She's got it on her tablet, Samsung Tab or something like that, and we go over it. Once we finish going over it, I'm free. I can go back to listening to things while I go into the bathroom and get 16 ounces of yogurt. Take the 16 ounces of yogurt into the bedroom, and then turn off the Kindle, stop listening to magazine articles, and watch a bunch of science TV. Or there's Link Asia is a show that gives you a lot of snippets from Japanese television, South Korean television, Chinese television, and gives you the news of what's going on in Asia.
From Link TV?
Link TV.
Yeah, a friend of mine started that.
Yeah, who's that?
Kim Spencer.
Oh, because his partner I met out on the West Coast.
Patrice?
I can't remember. It was a
guy. French guy was his partner a while ago.
Johnson or something like that. At any rate, he lives on a boat in the San Francisco Bay. At any rate, I think he was disgusted with my politics. He didn't. I sent him an email telling him how wonderful meeting him was, and he never sent me an email back. So, because my politics are totally in outer space. But at any rate, so we're at the, it's approximately...
You're watching Link TV?
Yeah, I'm watching Link TV while I'm eating my breakfast.
What is your breakfast?
It's 16 ounces of plain yogurt.
Plain yogurt, nothing else?
Nothing else, no.
And that's the first thing you've eaten?
Yeah, it's the first thing I've eaten during the day. That would be about 10:30 in the morning.
Okay, so you're up at 8, and then by 2.5 hours later, you're eating.
Yeah, I'm eating.
What time did you go to sleep?
Well, we'll get to that.
Right, okay.
Because we'll do the cycle. Okay, so it's 10:30, and I'm eating my yogurt, and I'm taking in Science TV, and I'm taking in Link TV for the Asian news. And then, when I finish the yogurt, I turn off the television, and I turn on the computer. And, well, the computer's on 24 hours a day, both of my computers, all of my computers are on 24 hours a day. So we switch the computer over to iTunes and make sure that I've got the latest copy, that morning's edition of the New York Times, which is on audio, and I put that on audio and go to sleep.
So at what time is that?
That's 11 o'clock.
11 o'clock.
Yeah. So I'm listening to that, and then it's all set up with iTunes, so when it finishes with that, it goes to Science News, the weekly roundup of news. It's a magazine that gives a weekly roundup of what's going
all
on in science.
Sleep.
Yeah, all in my sleep. And moves on from there to 60 Second Science for the little podcast from the Scientific American and the podcast from Nature and the podcast from Science, the two leading science journals,
sleep.
All in my sleep.
Now,
right.
Now, what is your sleep like?
Oh, it usually takes me what feels like about 15 minutes to fall asleep in the morning, but I'm listening to the New York Times, and I want to hear those articles, and then I get frustrated about the ones I can't hear because I fall asleep, especially if it's technology news. If it's about Apple or Google or Facebook or something like that, I get all excited about it, but it tends to come after I fall asleep. And I sleep very soundly almost all the time. And, we'll go to the walking in a minute. Well, we'll see why I sleep so soundly. So I wake up at 3 o'clock, precisely 3 o'clock in the afternoon, after having slept since 11:30. Yeah, I have, thank God for cell phones. You know, this gives you so many alarm functions, it's ridiculous. And it's the best wake-up tool I've ever seen in my life.
So you've got sleep from
11 o'clock. Until 3 o'clock in the afternoon.
So that's four and a half hours. 4.5 hours.
Yeah. Yeah. It's,
and you
that's
did
about
that
4 hours. Yes. Sleeping from, it's 4 hours. Yes. Every day. Absolutely every day. And I wake up at 3, and this time I listen to mostly science stuff in the afternoon, and again, spend a half an hour taking my pills, and put my clothes on and go. When under normal circumstances, right now I have an athletic injury to my foot, and I'm not allowed to go anywhere. Even walking to the front room is a bit too much right now. It's plantar fasciitis. I never heard of it before.
Neither have I. What is
it? It's horrible. Well, you have this ligament that goes all the way from your heel to your toes, and it is the sole of your foot for all practical purposes. And if you do certain things wrong, you end up with an irritation, an inflammation of that giant ligament that's everything you walk on. And it's very difficult. Yeah, it's very painful and very difficult to walk. So the only way to get beyond this is apparently don't use it. Don't walk.
But how did it happen in the first place?
I have these shoes. No, I'm not wearing them. I have these shoes that are barefoot shoes. They're
with the finger toes?
No, they don't have finger toes, but they are like dancer's shoes. You feel every bit of the ground. Now, one thing that happens when you get older is your soles of your feet desensitize. Two things happen. The soles of your feet desensitize, and you lose your sense of balance. So I challenge my sense of balance all the time. When I take my two-mile walks through the park, I walk on the curbs along the side of the walkway, not on the walkway. It's like I'm tightrope walking, except I don't have to put my arms out like this. So I challenge my balance. I come up the stairs two stairs at a time, all kinds of things like that. So I loved it that my feet could feel every little bit of the surface beneath them, the sidewalk or the ground or whatever I happened to be walking on. Well, what I didn't know is your feet need a certain amount of support, or the plantar fasciae, that ligament, gets inflamed. And once it gets inflamed, you can't walk anymore. So, but normally, on a normal day, at about 3:40, I finish, or 3:35, I finish taking all my pills, putting all my clothes on, all the time listening to science stuff. And I go out to the front room where Lachette, my assistant, has been working during normal hours. And I find out what's happening. I collect my laptop from her because she's been using it while I've been away, because that gives her access to my files. And there are a lot of files I want her to use. And even though she has a laptop out there and her own tablet out there, I get all the news from her. I was senile at the age of 10. Remember the scissors in my left hand? So I put my coat on, and we both stand at the door where there's a checklist of 12 items.
I noticed.
Yeah, to make sure I don't forget any of the most essential things. And she makes me, because I forget, she makes me go over the checklist item by item to make sure I've got each of these things, so I don't lock myself out of the house as I did once and had to sleep on the floor of a bookstore up on 7th Avenue. After the checklist is complete, I go out for my walk through Prospect Park. It's a two-mile walk. A two-mile walk to get to the tea lounge. Now, the tea lounge happens to be around the corner from me. So I take the two-mile walk. To be able to walk in Prospect Park. It does wonders for me. And I walk on the curbs. And meanwhile, what am I doing? That's my reading time. So that's the time it's allocated to books. And now I'm listening to books on my Kindle. I get to the tea lounge at approximately 5 minutes to five.
5 minutes to five. Not yeah. at five. Or
no, 5 minutes to five.
5 minutes to five.
Right.
You are that...
Yes. And this is an infrastructure of habit. Remember that we have to have a certain amount of spontaneity, but spontaneity without discipline is like a heap of muscles without a skeletal structure, without bones. It's useless. And all discipline with no spontaneity is like a heap of bones without muscles.
And what
it's
about
useless.
All discipline with no spontaneity?
With no spontaneity. It's like being a pile of bones. Bones of themselves, how often do you see a skeleton hanging in a biology lab moving anywhere? It doesn't. It doesn't have muscles anymore. Or that mysterious force of life. You need the two of them working in balance. It's like we have an extensor muscle and a tensor muscle in our arm. And what allows us to move our arm like this is the balance between the tensor or the extensor. But if you were to cut one of these muscles, cut this one, you know what happens to your arm when there's no longer a balance? No, it stays in that position forever. You can't move it. And the same thing if you cut this one. If you cut this one, it's in this position forever and you can't move it. It's the balance between opposites. In Bloomian philosophy, opposites are joined to the hip. And when you remove those opposites from each other, you remove the whole system that makes things go, because it's systems that make things go, not individual components working on their own. And that this is one of the ways in which Aristotle got it wrong. You can understand the elements all you want. You can understand this muscle all you want. You can understand this muscle all you want. But if you don't understand how the two muscles work together in a synergistic system in which the whole is bigger than the sum of its parts, you don't understand anything. And Aristotelian thinking will only get you a certain distance. You need it the way you need discipline. But you need it along with naturalistic observation, which is something Aristotle, ironically, was brilliant at. You need that empirical evidence. And you need to balance that against the rigidity of this concept of reducing things to their elements and understanding everything. What we tend to do in modern physics with the atom smasher at CERN, that 15-mile ring in which atoms are smashed together, it's the equivalent of, I really want to understand how a teacup is made. And Aristotle says that if I understand what its elements are and I understand their rules, then I'll understand the teacup. So this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to take this teacup and smash it on the floor and analyze its elements. Well, you'll never figure out how a teacup is made that way. You have to understand the history of the Chinese, the history of pottery, how clay works when it's run into a fire, what a ceramic is, what a ceramic surface is, and you have to understand the context. You have to understand what a tea ceremony is, for God's sakes, and what tea is, and how that fits into a human life, into an infrastructure of habit, whether it's in England and tea is taking place at 4 p.m, or it's in Japan or China, where, for all I know, tea takes place at a different time of day. You have to understand the big picture in order to really understand the fucking teacup and how it was made. And Aristotle only looks at what happens if you smash the thing and take it apart. Take it apart into little bitty pieces, which aren't even necessarily the functional units. They're arbitrary units. So, at any rate.
But didn't Aristotle get lost in that empirical world, but he didn't go far enough?
What Aristotle did is this. Aristotle put this vast amount of empirical information together. He was a natural observer of everything.
He was an observer
of everything from human societies and how kingships worked and how money. He was the one who originally introduced the idea of futures buying. He did it by analyzing Thales. Thales, the very first philosopher of all time in ancient Miletus. And Aristotle told the following story about Thales. This is how far Aristotle's interests went. He said that Thales was sitting around whatever the equivalent of a cafe was in those days, and some rich guys came up to him and said, you, with your philosophy, you know, all this big thinking and you're advising kings and stuff like that, I make money. You don't even know how to make money. That's how little you understand. So Thales said, I'm going to make some money. I'll show you. And I'm paraphrasing here. And Thales came up with a scheme. The guys who owned presses in which olives were pressed in order to get their oil, which was one of those valuable commodities in the ancient world, these guys only were able to rent out their presses for roughly 3 weeks or 4 weeks of the year, just after the olive harvest. And then there was no income. They weren't making any money. So Thales went to these guys after the season was over, when they were making nothing, and said, I'm going to pay you money right now to buy the use of your olive presses for the next year. Well, these guys were desperate for cash. There was nothing coming in. They said, fine, give us the money. When the next harvest of olives came in, Thales was ready. He owned all the olive presses, and he made a fortune because he only had to pay pennies on the dollar, or the drachma, in order to rent these olive presses at a time of the year when they were in total disuse.
And what
thus was invented, well, he held on to the right to use them for a year, which meant that when the next harvest came in, he owned them. He owned the right to use them. So he was the one who collected the next harvest's money. In other words...
I thought he was going to make paper money. That's what I thought you were going with this story.
He did the equivalent. He had invented the futures contract.
Oh, okay, now I understand where you're going.
And Aristotle was the one who chronicled Thales inventing the futures contract, which means that Aristotle was theorizing about everything from government. It was Aristotle who came up with words like kleptocracy and plutocracy, and he did a whole, you know, set of the species of different kinds of government.
I have a website called Idiocracy.
Idiocracy? Well, we have a great deal of that, especially under George W. Bush.
Well, I made an art of it.
Yeah. So, at any rate, he was a great observer of everything from political structures and economic structures and how-to in economics to the sex lives of clams. Literally. He was great. But in two pages, just two pages, of one of his books, the two pages outlined a program for this thing he called science. And it involved breaking things down to their elements, and then understanding, then a metaphor. You know, laws are these rules that men make, but they're not called laws until men write them down and standardize them, which is something that was done by, oh God, what was his name? About 500 BC, the first laws were carved in stone. And they went from being just rules and customs to being laws. So Aristotle pulled off a metaphor. He said that natural elements, what he called elements, because he seems to have invented that word, operated, just like humans, according to laws. And if you could find out what those laws were, you understood everything. Plus, he said, metaphor is not science. Absolutely. Metaphor is not science.
Why would he say that?
Well, we'll get into I'm not sure I know the answer, but we'll get into that in a second. And what else was it he said in those two? These were magic two pages. These are the two pages. Oh, and he said, first outline your axioms.
Right.
Your givens, your assumptions about things. Then outline your definitions. Then outline your propositions. Now, have you ever seen two people in a bar arguing about what's your definition of that? Mm. Until you define that, it's not science. Guess where they got that from? Two pages in Aristotle. Two miserable, tiny little pages in Aristotle. And we keep repeating it like parrots. See what original creatures we are? See what distance we have, or what critical distance from the things that we do? So these two pages of Aristotle came to dominate science for the next 2,300 years, and we parrot them. So with such precision, we don't know where they came from. We think we're the first ones to say, oh, but that's metaphor, not science. Well, guess what Aristotle was using when he talked about elements and natural laws, those things that were chiseled in stone that had been just informal rules. He was using metaphor. We can't do science without metaphor. Guess who came up with the metaphor of the particle versus the wave? Two different metaphors that have been at the base of theoretical physics ever since. Leonardo da Vinci. Leonardo da Vinci. But we like to think these things had no origins, so that we can think that they're parts, natural parts of the universe. The idea of what happens when you put together elements and find their laws. Well, you call the result of your thinking process elementary laws. Well, we act as if elementary laws is, that phrase is a feature of the natural world, not something that we invented. If we knew Aristotle had invented it and how we had invented it, we get a certain distance from it and we'd be able to get beyond it. It's time to get beyond it. It's stupid. You cannot say that you will understand the arm simply by understanding its elements, this muscle and this muscle, without understanding a balance between the muscles and the larger synergistic dynamic they make possible. You don't understand the arm. We don't understand life. We don't understand consciousness. Why? Because our tools of analysis are Aristotelian, from two lost pages of Aristotle, and we haven't gone beyond them. And it is time to start looking at the big picture. Now, looking at the big picture has been a struggling element of science since at least the 19th century. Goethe, you know, the guy who wrote Faust, the guy who we know primarily in the West as a poet and an artist, he was also a scientist. And he was into the science of what we would call holistic science, putting all the pieces together to see the larger thing that emerges when you put together the parts. What happens when you put together parts? Well, when you were a kid, did you ever take baking soda and pour vinegar on it? You certainly got a hole bigger than the sum of its parts. The baking soda was just a powder. And the vinegar was just a liquid. And you could say, if you were going to be Aristotelian, all I have to do is look at the vinegar in the bottle and understand its laws, and look at the baking soda in a pile and understand its laws, and I understand everything. Well, from looking at merely the powder and the liquid in a bottle, would you ever predict that frizzy, frothy foam that comes very actively spurting when you pour the liquid on the powder? No, you wouldn't have a clue. So understanding the elements is not enough. Understanding the emergent whole, just the emergent whole, put oxygen together with hydrogen and link them together in the right way, and you get something that's so radically different. From oxygen is a gas. Hydrogen's a gas. If by understanding the laws of the elements, I understand the whole thing, then it's easy. Put oxygen together with hydrogen, gas together with gas. The laws are the laws of a gas. So what are you going to get? A gas. Right? Aristotle told you so. How could Aristotle possibly be wrong? Now, put a match in. What should happen? Well, all you're adding is warmth, right? So you should get a warmer gas. But you put the match in and you get two emergent properties you would never have predicted in a million years. One is an explosion. Huh? The laws of a gas don't explain an explosion. The laws of two gases don't explain an explosion. The laws of heating two gases don't explain an explosion. And you get this really weird substance that wobbles around the table and eventually spills over the edge onto your lap, embarrasses the hell out of you, and you don't want to stand up in the presence of women for the next 25 minutes until it's dried off, because it'll look like you peed in your pants. It's called water, and it's the weirdest stuff in the world, and you cannot predict it from the laws of two gases plus heat. Not at all. So everything we look at in the world around us is the product of what are called emergent properties. And the idea of looking at the whole instead of just the sum of the parts has been with us since Goethe in the early 1800s, and a bunch of other Germans who were very much into looking at the larger whole that emerges. But Germany lost two world wars in the 20th century. Who's going to pay attention to Germans anymore? Well, it's time to pay attention to the Germans, not the ones who wanted to kill you and me because we were Jews, but the ones who saw the larger whole emerging as a synergistic entity when you put the parts together and know that you don't always get the sum of the natural laws of the elements of which this thing is composed. So it's time for that kind of science. Now, I'm old-fashioned in proclaiming that it's time for that kind of science. What I'm proclaiming goes all the way back 200 years. But it's time to apply it, for God's sakes, and even get beyond it. Why? By getting both beyond what we call reductionist science that breaks the teacup and then analyzes the pieces, and holistic science that tries to look at the whole picture of the emergence of Chinese culture and how we invented clay. How we invented the use of clay. Clay was one of those useless, poisonous things that we turn from a poison into a resource. What do I mean a poison? That sounds ridiculous about clay. Well, if you've ever lived through the rainy season in the Middle East, living through it is hard. Because when you go out of your, assuming you have a habitat, if you go out of your habitat, you're up to your knees in muck. And the muck can kill you. Because walking in the muck 100 yards is almost impossible. And to sustain yourself, you have to walk thousands of yards. That's why in really mucky places, like the boglands of England, we find bog people. People who bogged down in the mud and never got out of it alive and are still there 4,000 to 5,000 years later. That's poisonous stuff. What did we humans do? We learned how to take this mud and turn it into, first of all, rectangular units, modular units, that we put together 60 million of them at a time. Look, Gio, if you had been the first one to come up with this idea of using mud to make rectangular units, and I had been a normal, sane human being, you would have said, we're going to take the mud, the stuff that kills you, we're going to take it and we're going to pat it into rectangular units. And I would have said, Gio, look, you're a madman. There is no such thing as rectangular units. Look around you. Look at the stars in the heavens. They're all tiny little circles, right? Look at the Earth. Okay, it's flat. I'll give you that. But there is no such thing as flat surfaces and this geometric stuff you're talking about. Plus, Gio, you're telling me the reason we're going to do this, you're telling me we're going to have to do this for the next 30 years. Take mud and pat it into rectangular units and leave it in the sun to dry. And you're trying to tell me that if I do this for 30 years and everybody around me does this for 30 years, eventually we'll have enough of these mud things to make a new form of housing? Gio, come off it. You know, you got to be crazy to go along with what you're talking about here. Housing. Caves make housing. Where's your brain? And yet, you would have been right. And we would have been, if we'd followed you, we would have taken the stuff that's not a resource, a poison, and turned it into a resource and made the very first housing units. They're three-room, single-family housing units. Single families had never had a place to live by themselves before. They'd lived with other groups of others in caves or in big, long buildings without real separation. Privacy had not existed before. No one had seen a flat wall, ever. Not in the history of the universe. They had never existed anywhere, unless you wanted to look at fine crystal structures, which you couldn't because you had no microscopes. And right angles, what happens when two flat walls meet? Never in the history of the universe had these things existed. And you, Gio, with your craziness, telling me that this stuff that obviously is not a resource, but a poison, this muck, could be turned into housing? You got to be crazy. And the first Katal Hayuk, the first building made, or the first city made this way, housed 60,000 people. Gio, you idiot. How the fuck did you pull that off?
I can't tell you. It was good. I did a good job.
Yes.
I didn't let people know it was me.
So, what are the lessons of this? First of all, every poison is a resource in disguise.
Mm-hmm. Interesting point. And yeah. Medicine, too.
Waiting to be invented. Waiting for the larger purpose, the synergistic purpose, to be invented that puts it to use. Remember, those 200 million ounces of dead stuff for every ounce of life stuff on this planet. That's just stuff waiting to be invented into new forms of life. What did the first cells do? They invented ways to take poisons like phosphorus and sulfur and turn them into energy sources. Into energy sources and energy transport sources. Without them, you know, nitrogen, what's nitrogen? Well, without nitrogen, hydrogen, and carbon, you wouldn't be here and I wouldn't be here. Life found ways to use these useless things, and sometimes poisonous, destructive, horrid things. And that's what life is all about. That's your obligation, my obligation, and the obligation of modern civilization, is to do that day after day after day after day after day. So that's lesson number one from all of this. And lesson number two is we have to develop a science of the larger wholes that emerge when individual elements come together. We've had 2,300 years of indulgence in elemental science. What does that mean? The science of breaking things down into parts. Now we have to have a science of the miracles that happen, the secular miracles, the material miracles that happen when you put things together and add things like imagination.
Imagination. What is that like?
Well, here's a big trick. You know, imagination comes up a lot when you're talking to creationists. And I'm about to run out of energy, so I don't know what to do about the Howard the Humongous. We'll have to do one tomorrow. Yeah. But imagination is this really weird stuff. The reason that the creationists, or one reason, have you run out of life there?
No, I have a battery charger.
Okay.
Go ahead.
But one reason that the creationists are just a little bit wacky is this. Imagination is actually an attribute, a talent, an astonishment based on a limitation of the brain. And that limitation of the brain is this. one of the aspects of life that it's most important to understand is that life is based on the universe mirroring herself in new forms, the universe symbolically representing herself in new forms. DNA is a symbolic representation of the empirical world. In fact, it's a symbolic representation of the larger holes that we're talking about that emerge in the larger world, because DNA can't get away with the stupidity of reductionism. DNA has got to get it right, or it's not going to survive. So DNA is this immense symbolic representation in a system that's much more complex than bits and bytes. It's in atoms, long, long strings of atoms. If you took a genome, a human genome, and you stretched it out because it is one single molecule, one single connected molecule, it's 3 feet long and so thin you can't see it.
Wow.
It's an amazing string of stuff. And think of the size of an atom compared to 3 feet of stuff. There's space for billions of them. This is really complex code being used to code the empirical structure of the world, at least in which we live, and to constantly find ways to empirically reflect new aspects of the world to take advantage of them. Niches are not given by God or nature. Niches are made by invention. DNA invents ways to take former poisons or wildernesses and turn them into Gardens of Eden. Gardens of Eden are invented, not given by nature. There is no loving and generous nature. All there is a loving and somewhat greedy string of not just DNA, but life stuff that's out there to take as much of the universe as it can and figure out how to use it. And that's great. That's what life is all about. So don't think that we're violating nature, because we're doing what nature asks us to do. When we make pollutants, hey, we didn't invent toxic pollutants. Once upon a time, there were these incredibly inventive microorganisms, unbelievably inventive. These microorganisms did the equivalent of this. We all know that the world is made of material things. We've been life, you know, we've been around now for a few hundred million years, and we've been surviving by taking a whole bunch of atoms and putting them together into a brand new kind of team that can anticipate what's going on in the environment by perceiving underlying patterns and then adapting to them, inventing ways to ride them, the way a surfer rides a wave. But you're one species and I'm another species, right? And you say to me, because Gio, you keep saying these wacky things, and you say to me, see that stuff that isn't material at all? And it's poisonous to us? Radiation? Made of photons? I'm going to grab those immaterial photons. They have no mass whatsoever. I'm going to grab them. I'm going to make use of them inside my cell. Gio.
I'm sorry.
You've done it again.
I have this way of getting into your mind.
Right. This is impossible. What the hell are you talking about? All we've done, we've been here 100 million years. And yeah, I admit, we have taken sulfur, we have taken phosphorus, and we've used these things to make energy. But this is material things. These are made of atoms. Don't you get it? They're hard and fast. You can grab them. There's nothing hard and fast about radiation. Nothing. All it does is kill us. And Gio, you go out and invent photosynthesis. It's one of the most complex processes the universe has ever seen. It's an industrial process. It operates via mass production. Photosynthetic cells, they're called cyanobacteria, reproduce themselves by the trillions of trillions. That's mass production.
I'm pretty good, aren't I?
You're amazing. You're capturing this stuff and turning a non-material thing into material stuff. What the fuck are you up to?
I cannot tell a lie.
Yeah. And so, at any rate, the point is that resources are not given to us by nature. They are seized from nature by a process of invention. Now, you were asking what imagination is. You cyanobacteria, you.
Oh, thank you. Finally, someone is recognized
yes,
by true,
right.
my true worth.
Yes. You have invented all of this without imagination. Why? Because what's imagination? Imagination is something that happens only when you have a brain. Why is it something that happens only when you have a brain? Because when you have a brain, first of all, your ancestors, as a hominid, your ancestors made their way around the world via a sense of smell. They stayed out of the way by day because they could too easily be eaten by dinosaurs, and they came out at night. And at night, the sense that counts is not your sense of vision, it's your sense of olfaction. It's your nose. You could see this in a rat or a mouse today who's a very close cousin of yours. I can prove it by comparing your genome. And so you started out with this great smell sense, which is what bacteria have. They follow a chemotactic gradient. What does that mean? They get the whiff of things. They sense a bunch of molecules coming their way and tapering off. And from the tapering off, they can tell which direction the source of these molecules is. And sensing molecules is called smell or taste. So your ancestors were taste-oriented, smell-oriented. And they made their way down from the trees, and they have this great hippocampus, this thing that helps you. It's a map maker. So you made a map of the scents in your area that gave you a Google map in terms of where things were and how they smelled, how long it took to walk there and how they smelled. And you're great at that. But then the dinosaurs are wiped out. And then you get
don't
a chance.
Blame me on that one.
Right.
I would never have done that.
And then you get a chance to take over. And humans in particular develop, instead of this olfactory sense, the olfactory sense shrinks and is replaced by visual senses. We are one of the most visual species on the face of the earth, although hawks and eagles are very visual too, but in a very different way. So we end up evolving in this super brain of ours that's three times the size of the brains of our ancestors 2.5 billion years ago, the ones who made the first stone tools. Our brains are three times the size of our ancestors who made the first stone tools. What's in all that brain? 40 visual centers, approximately, because the number changes depending on which scientist is doing the counting. What does that have to do with imagination? Well, let's see. What's the word imagination derived from?
Hold that thought. I have to change the...
chip?
Change it to a chip. Come on.
Out of memory? Internal memory?
No. Yeah. Just let me get this here. Okay. Oh, damn it. Just one second. Where is that? Media selection. Oh, come on. Why? It's still recording. It's not supposed to be recording. Why are you recording? Hold on.